Father in heaven, thank you for today. Thank you for this Sunday. Thank you that we are here to worship you, to love you, to be with you, each and every one of us. I pray that you touch each and one of us, our hearts, our minds, our spirits, with your presence, your glory, and your love. I thank thee for my family here. I thank thee for all of us. Give me the strength and the wisdom. Give us all your blessings. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand with me.
Oh.
Water and sky, heaven. desire and I long to worship thee.
An animal sacrifice to Passover was proclaimed, and the death of an angel passed over Israel. At the cross, love himself became the sacrifice, and death of an angel will pass over us. When he returns, we shall rise to meet him. The price of this victory over the grave was paid for us at Calvary. For this reason, we remember the full extent of his love.
Thank you. Just over the hilltop, in that bright land where Children's Church, maybe some of us. Tracy always forgets, I just assumed, so you probably...
As I said, Pastor Tracy asked me, well, actually, she kind of volunteered me, I mentioned her name. Kind of voluntary, which was, that's great, because I've, one time, a manager for Don John Silver, and I used to have to speak at seminars and meetings, and 50, 60, 100 people at a time. Well, I thought about that, and I thought, well, I sit back and spoke about fish. Cleanliness, quality, courtesy. I thought to myself, you know, well, that's just right. All those things. So, I can speak how to prepare fish, make bread, teach people how to be nice and courteous and cleanliness, whatever. I thought, well, maybe I might be able to speak about the Lord.
Amen.
I tried. First of all, I want to tell you about a preacher. And he took his congregation down to the city park. They had a big lake there. He wanted to do baptisms. And so everybody was gathered, a big congregation. This girl kind of stumbles up there and doesn't know what motion is. Comes to the preacher and he goes, "Preacher, what's going on here?" He says, "We're finding Jesus. Do you want to find Jesus today, son?" "Yeah." So he takes them, puts them under the wall, brings them back up. "Have you found Jesus yet?" "No." Puts them under the water again, brings them back up. Says, "Have you found Jesus yet?" "No." Preacher gets a little frustrated here. He grabs them, puts them down. He keeps them down there for a while. Brings them back up. "Finally, son, have you found Jesus?" Son goes, "No, Pastor, I don't think he's down there." That's my sermon. That's my sermon about finding Jesus. I guess that don't give you an understanding. And sometimes we all need to understand. It took me a long time to say understand. And John 14, verses 18 to 20. It says, "I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore. But you will see me, because I live. You also will. On that day, you will realize I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you." It's about where I began my journey. Is when was Jesus in me? And I had to really go back and think about that, because as I grew up, I was about 7 years old. Me and my sister went to this little church in Bluffton, Indiana, cherished it. And we'd go there every Sunday. Finally, one Sunday came up, the pastor came to us, and he says, "Where do you live? I like going to see you, visit you with you, blah, blah, blah." But I told him where I lived. And pastor came over, talked to my mom, that time I had a stepfather. And he sat back, and you know, once he got in there, you know, introduced my mom, whatever, and we went to play, me and my sister did. But when he walked out by the door, his face was just wide as paint. He just went through the gates of hell. You see, my mother never believed in God. You know, she let us go to church, but my mom still did today don't believe in God, don't believe in church. She always say, "Them preachers are bad people. Hell, they want your money." I never believed that. I never believed that. But the preacher did ask for money, but that was a good thing, you know. My mom never realized that. But that was my first journey of finding Jesus, but did he find me? I still back and reflect on that as I do my journey to where all of these years that even my sister today went to church with me, but yet she won't go to church. She's come to the point where she don't believe in God. It hurt, it hurt, it's sad. Because, you know, I like to talk to him, you know, about how I feel, how Jesus, what Jesus had done to me. So I lived a life thinking not to go to church. That church was bad. There's one little thing. Tell me, Jesus. All through these years, I turn away. Keep pulling me back. I go this way. Pull me back. I wasn't walking with him. Just hold his hand. You know what I mean? He would hold my hand sometimes. Sometimes he'd wheel there, but he kept pulling. Finally, last year, I kept pulling. I had this emptiness inside. Something that just was not fulfilled. So I started pulling back. It's sometimes when we, as we journey through our life, is finding him. It's not so much is what I learned, as he found me, because he never gave up. Even as I was always a sinner, I was doing wrong things, I was a hero, something like that, he never gave up. I don't think he gives up on anybody, really. It's just that you need to find him. In Jeremiah 32, verses 40, I will make with them an everlasting covenant, and I will put the fear of me in their hearts, that they may not turn from me. To me, that's basically what Jesus did at that time, 7 years old. So he kind of put fear in my heart of God. So I, with that fear inside of me, I he was there, I was not. I sit back and each and every one of us sit back and search each other sometimes and say, well, how did we find you? Do you ever remember the first time that you found him, you found you? Sit back and think about it. When did I first find you? Some of y'all have been going to church for many years. So it's been a long time. Some of us, just, you know, a couple of years, one day. Some of us may have never had. I've got my son and daughter here, praise the Lord. I told them I speak today. They come here when I speak, I'm going to find me another job. They come to church, I'm happy. Thank you all for coming. Still got to get a little job. But as finding Jesus, to me, some of us is our own personal, it's a personal relationship, it's personal. Some people could be an alcoholic, some people could be a drug addict, some people could be so many things in your life that would take you and say, I give up, I need to go there. Something's missing in my life. What is it? Jesus. Okay. Hey, I'm here. I'm here. Right here. That's it. Right here. I have another truth is that once Jesus is there, he transforms you. And I'm just telling you a little testimony of mine, how he transformed me. Is that I never, like I said, ever went to church, and I'm going to tell you right now, this is the first time in my life I've ever been a member of church. My wife and I, we got married. I promised her that we'd find a church. Don't get me wrong, I believed in it. I believe ever since I've been little, I just never went to church. And we tried to find one church, but I didn't come to one. I'll tell you a little bit how we found this one. I travel a lot, I work in sales posting. And I always take exit 43 to go home. I always seen these three little light boxes. And it just kept catching my attention. I kept driving by them, seeing them. And let's check this out. I wrote down church, Google Christian Church. Been about a year ago. And I told my wife about it. She didn't say a lot. So let's go online and check it out. So let's see if we last one, maybe it was half Methodist, half Catholic, or something like that. We didn't want to go there. But it was in, you know, I found out this church was a non-denominational church. And that was awesome. And so we attend. I said, all right, let's go. But the three little white crosses, this church, the Spirit told me, you know, this is the one. This is where you need to be. Praise the Lord. And didn't y'all? Well, thank God. I love that. I love you guys. You welcome us with open arms and open hearts. And it's an honor and privilege to attend this church. You know, my wife will. It's anyway, two scoops of here. Oh, a scoop, that's not this one. But I never, my wife had, she went to church prior to our marriage for like 3-4 years. Somewhere longer than that. And so her pastor married us, knowing that, you know, I was a believer, but he asked me to be able, did you ever go to church? So, no. I said, the kingdom of God is within me. And for, giving away my age here, 50 years per se, the kingdom of God was in me. For I didn't go to church. I read my Bible. You know what I mean? I just didn't go to church. I read my Bible. That kingdom was in me. There was something missing, though. Missing of fellowship. I never knew nothing about until I started attending this church. But believing in Jesus from as a child to now has been very, very up and down experiences, and I'm sure for a lot of people it's up and down experiences. That sometimes we lose what it's all about. We try to be, get so wrapped up in just being a Christian. So, I mean, reading the Bible and gotta do this and do that, and we just get wrapped up in it sometimes. Or we get wrapped up in our work. Children, or other things that we, that distracts us from the real meaning of finding Jesus. Corinthians 6:19. This might be a little bit out of the wall. But God here says, you are not of your own, for you are bought with Christ. And wow. That's something that was really dawned on me before, is the meaning of that communion. Because before I came to this church, I never took communion. Never remembered it ever in my life. I thought it was what Catholics do. You see it on TV all the time. But I really didn't know. I really didn't know. Until I came to this church. And I did my first communion, my wife and I, together. First time. And I was a little bit nervous as well. I don't know if I'm worthy of it. This was something different for me. And but then my wife kind of explained it to me. She goes, no, it's just you saying you love Jesus. I never thought of it. Still, just a way of saying, Jesus, I love you. Thank you for what you've done for us. Thank you. Pain, suffering, the blood. Thank you for everything that you have done. Not just me, just the poor. Galatians 2:20. Says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me. Gave himself for me. To where once you come to Christ, once you, the way I feel, is that I no longer live. No longer need that. I would say a year ago, maybe I'd say maybe, I can't remember, like 7 years old, I guess. I guess 7 years old is when it started to where I was. So, it wasn't me. It was Jesus. And by tugging, by doing that, is where finally at last, as you all, some of you were here, my wife and I got baptized. And unfortunately, Pastor Tracy got jumped a few times. I felt so bad. Like, I mean, oh my goodness. I really felt bad. But I'm glad he's all right. But when we got baptized, I was thinking, sky's going to open up, and you know what I mean? I didn't know what to think. I really didn't. I just remember saying, Lord, now I'm definitely yours. Before Pastor Tracy ducked me, pulled me back up, I said, Lord, I am yours. Do with me whatever. I never imagined I'd stay in this. But I would do what the Lord said. Or tell me that I am yours. That's how that but as his verses, I found Jesus way long before that baptism. I found him way long before I started coming to this church. I found him way long before my mother told me that churches were bad, preachers are no good. God is not. I hope y'all has came from a family that has that you brought up with the Bible. You've been brought up Christianity. Some of us have, some of us don't. There's one little old lady that I sit back and I remember that also had Jesus. And that was my parents. She's in heaven. She sat back and told me, I am Jesus. And she'd sing these hymns, those old bluegrass, tucky stuff. She'd sing those hymns to me, and I would tell me, I'd sit back and listen to her. Never really knew what it was all about, but she'd listen to me. She took care of my father. And all through the years, when I was a teenager, and I was just a rebel without cause, she'd sit back and she pulled Bible verses to me. Grandmother could never read or write one thing. She was a jerky Indian from the hills of Kentucky. Never learned how to read. She knew the Bible. And she'd tell me one time, I was young, I had long hair. She'd sit back and tell me, it's a sin to have long hair. And the Bible says so. My grandma had pictures of Jesus everywhere, long hair. I never questioned it. Could not understand that. God bless her soul. She's just so awesome. And she sit back and just, you know, as a kid, we Bible students, Bible students. So that was Jesus. Do my grand. Tell you that. And as time went on, you know, I say about 5-6 years ago, one day I said, Lord, I just don't understand. So I was going through like a midlife crisis. What's it called that? It's not my fault. I was 45 years old, you know what I mean? Midlife crisis, I guess you'd say. And, you know, finally I said, Lord, I don't know why I'm so confused. I don't know what's going on with me. I don't know. And I seemed like I was looking for something that wasn't there, and I finally said, I never. When I did that day, a peace. Peace came over me. That day I got on my hands and knees and I cried like a baby. And that's when he took his spirit. Harvest. I mean, he was there, but Jesus kind of made a jump. You know, boom. Got close. Now we're holding hands. Now we're buddy buddies. You know what I mean? it changed me completely to where I started seeing things I never seen. What I mean by that is I started seeing what I'm doing wrong. That first thing. Why did you do that? The Spirit told me, deal with it. No, that's not good. I'm not saying I was a bad guy, but I wasn't doing anything. I just wasn't doing what I should have been doing. That Spirit beat me up. No, no, you can't do that. That's the way I feel. I mean, it could be different. He's like, you can't do that. Next pastor, you can't do that. So guilty about me. But that's my journey and finding Jesus. I still sit back and did he find me? Because I looked at myself, my mother, my sister, don't believe. But yeah, I always have. So I wonder, why did he pick me? I'm sure he picked my mother. I'm sure he picked my sister. I mean, they're still not one. I hope and pray, I pray every day that somehow some light comes into them and says, hey, God is for real, I'm here. But I hope that day comes because I want to see him dead. It'll be a sad day. Maybe go to heaven without my brother and my sister. Without any of my family. Without any. But how did Jesus, why was I just that one person out there? Why did he? Because he loved me. Because he loved me and he loved me from the beginning. He wanted me for a reason. I still don't know today, except he just loved me. We all sit back and wonder, you know, what, now as you're a Christian, you know, what's my purpose in life? What do I do? What do I do with my life? I want to go out there on the streets and have a sign saying, yeah, I love Jesus. I mean, I would want to. I thought I'd arrest him. That's all I'm not into. I might get hit by a car here on the radio, on the TV, I forgot to send a sign to get hit by a car. That's terrible. I feel like I want to do something, I just don't know what to do. So what the Lord tells me, patience, just be patient. And that's what I feel God has in life, is have patience. The Lord will come and tell you what you need to do for Him. Because once I was baptized, my life was sure. Take me to what you want. I'll take it. The next day, what are we going to do? Go to ministry? I mean, I just don't know what. But I be patient. Let him guide you. Continue going to church. Continue. Of course, always love him. And continue fighting with Jesus. That's what I think. Continue. Because I believe we never end our life ever trying to find Jesus. It's a life, once you're a Christian, it's a lifelong hunger. The Spirit's in you, you're here. And like I said earlier, sometimes we get wrapped up in what we do and we forget about what Jesus really is all about. Romans 8:11. If the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwell in you, He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will again give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you. Now life to me is this love. Everything in the world is love. It's like how I gotta sit back sometimes about. Someone say a new Christian, I guess you could say, not really, really, really just walking with Jesus. I mean, I read my Bible and I go to Bible study and I do all that. And all these verses come out of me and I listen to Christian radio from, I'm on the road for 8 hours, sometimes it's 6 to 8 hours a day. I'm listening to sermons, I'm listening to this, I mean, it's just overwhelming to me. It's like, where's all this coming from? And time, I had to sit back and just say to myself, well, okay, start from the beginning. How did you find Jesus? Start there. How was it? I just looked at it and said, you know what? I just got to get Jesus. Sometimes we have to just give up. I'm not saying stop reading the Bible. No, I get to come off my scripture. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that sometimes in life, I just got to take a break. It's like stepped there with my granddaughter. So she sees me, what she does, she comes up with little bitty arms and just gives me a hug around my neck and just says, I love you. Boy, I felt so good. I'm tearing her off. Felt so good. And that's what sometimes I feel that Jesus wants from us. Be like that little child. Just reach down inside of us. Give them out. Let that spirit just pour inside you and just hold it. And then you can't do it physically, but you do it spiritually. Just hold it. And that's what I had to do. I just had to hold them. And that just, it was just like energizing my battery. I kind of like the internet, my battery. It just energized it so much. And that's what I get, is that sometimes you just all need. Some of us that hasn't found them, as a worship band, prepare to say praise. My voice in a minute, but I'd like to sing it. Let me go down. I'm not done. Finding Jesus again, all over again. Even though he lives with us, we walk with him, we love him, we praise him. We read the Bible every Sunday, every day, and go worship on Sunday, and all that. Like I said, sometimes you just get a little torn away from everything, and so involved in other stuff, and you just, you know what I mean? You just, my memory, I could be different for everybody else. Mine was just sitting back and saying, I love you, Jesus. I just can't. And for those of you that haven't found them, I promise you that when you come, say, Lord, come into my life. I'm a sinner. I promise you, it will be the life-changing thing. It would be the best thing you ever had in your life. I promise you. So if you haven't accepted Jesus, do it today. Don't wait. Don't wait 40-some years before I started really walking. Before I started hugging and holding. Reading His Word. Don't wait now. None of us has. I'm just asking you today, take time out and just give them a hug. Just give them a big, big hug. That's all I have to say.
We're going to offer him an invitation. If you know something going at you, I'll try.
Father in heaven, thank you for today. Thank you we was able to come here, worship, and praise you. I ask you, Lord, that as we leave today, that we sit back, give thanks, and give you a hug. Just stop in our tracks, and just reach down and give you a hug. I pray, Lord, that we meet here next Sunday. Worship you and give thanks to you. You've done so much for us. You've filled us up so much. I pray that the Spirit